Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Good afternoon for those of you joining us in Redmond campus. Good evening for those of you joining us across the world. And good morning for those of you joining us across the world, but in other parts of the world. Welcome to an exciting event here today at Microsoft. And let me start out by saying thank you to MSPAC and Microsoft Research Speaker Series for making this event possible, and Microsoft GLEAM as well. It's definitely quite a nice treat and delight to have such a great author with us today. Who will be coming in just a second. So today we will have the format, formal with the research series. We'll have, the speech, the remarks, and then we'll have, hopefully some questions, from the audience. We want to see some good participation. And at the end, we'll be doing, for those of you that got the book, we had them at the back, we'll be doing a signing of the book by the author today. So Armistead MaupinΓÖ was born in Washington, D.C., in 1944, but grew up in Raleigh, North Carolina, a graduate of University of North Carolina. He served as a naval officer in the Mediterranean with the River Patrol Force in Vietnam. MaupinΖÖ worked as a reporter for a newspaper in Charleston, South Carolina, before assigned to the San Francisco Bureau of the Associated Press in 1971. In 1976, he launched groundbreaking Tales of the City serials in the San Francisco Chronicle. MaupinΖÖ is the author of 9 novels, including 6 volume tales in the City series, Maybe the Moon, The Night Listener, and most recent, The Days of Anna Madrigal. It is a great privilege to be able to welcome Armistead MaupinΖÖ to Microsoft. Thank you, Brad.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This is the end of a 40-year-old story that I've been telling, the 9th novel in the Tales of the City series. I've been very lucky because in creating these characters, I've not only created a career for myself, but friends who grew out of the people who eventually came and played the characters. I'm thinking specifically of Olympia Dukakis, who played Anna Madrigal in the PBS television series exactly 20 years ago. Olympia and I have become great friends. She's very much Anna Madrigal in her own life. She's in the sense of being an earth mother, a passionate, loving person. She invited me and my husband, Chris, to come to Hollywood this year when she got her walk on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. When she told me it was happening, I said, about fucking time. How long did... It was a fun day to be with her on Hollywood Boulevard. Her star is in front of the Pantages Theater, named after a Greek, which made her very happy. And the person presenting the star to her formally, making the speech of the appreciation speech, was Ed Asner, Mr. Grant, from those of you who even remember the Mary Tyler Moore Show, or if you're 4 years old, he's the old guy in Up. And he's very much like the old guy in Up, actually, and very funny. And he had a cameo in the Tales of the City miniseries, so I was able to go up to him and said, hi, I'm Armistead MaupinΖÖ, and thank you so much for being in the show. And I said, and I'd like you to meet, I should back up and tell you that my husband Chris is 28 years older than, yes, my 112-year-old brother. Chris is 28 years younger than I am and catches eyes. And I said to Ed, this is my husband, Chris Turner, and Ed sort of looked him up and down and turned to me and said, you've got good taste. And then he turned to Chris and said, and I want to thank you for getting another senior citizen off the streets. so That compliment was paid me this year by somebody from Tales of the City. And then my friend Laura Linney, who played Marianne Singleton, really bowled me over by, I don't know if you read, but 3 weeks ago she gave birth to a baby boy, and the baby boy's middle name is Armistead. So I did that too. Well, actually, I was a little louder about it. I was in the dentist chair in Santa Fe, flat on my back, getting my teeth cleaned when she called and told me that the baby had been born and that she'd named him Bennett Armistead Shower. He better do something important with a big cinder block of a name like that. But, I want to read to you a little bit today from The Days of Anna Madrigal, and then we can chat afterwards. Just throw questions at me. I may even ask you to all move up closer at some point, just so we can make that more intimate. But right now, I'll read to you from a distance. And I'll let you choose. There are two passages that I've conventionally read from. Can you hear me all right, by the way? This is working, right? I don't have to focus on this at all. This is the first and the second chapter, so they both sort of explain themselves. This is the first time I've ever gone back in time with Tales of the City. I've always written in real time and followed, trusted my instincts in the moment. Because this is about my matriarch, Anna, here, I thought it would be fun to show what made her, where she came from. She grew up, some of you may know, in a whorehouse in Winnemucca, Nevada. Maybe you didn't know that. I don't know. So I had to go back to 1936 in order to tell this story and figure out what that environment was about. First chapter is about Anna today with her caretaker in San Francisco, a night at home with the two of them. He's a trans man who's not yet 40, and they have a kind of wonderful, odd couple relationship, the two of them. He cares for her. She's 92. So you get to vote on Anna today or Anna or Whorehouse Anna.
Yeah.
All right, that's a revolution. You want to do the brothel, you want to do the 1936 stuff. Okay. All I need is my glasses and I'll be right with you. I must say the internet was enormously useful in researching this. You could Google. It's Google. Do I get to say Google here? No. What should I have said? You can Bing. You can. Oh, there's so many minefields to. You can Bing 1930s whorehouse menu, and you can actually see one. We'll show you what items were for sale. Not items, but services. And when we get to that, you'll know probably. The chicken was in the pen out back, and the ruckus it was making woke Andy from an afternoon nap. They had not kept poultry for some time, so he figured Margaret was turning a trick with the Okie from down the road, who sometimes paid in livestock. He wondered if Violet had heard the chicken and if she would be ugly about it at dinner and hurt Margaret's feelings again. Andy couldn't see why doing it for a good hen was any less respectable than doing it for a couple of bucks. He rolled on his side and gazed at the window shade. It had darkened to amber during his nap, and the acacia bush swam against it like mint in a glass of iced tea. These hot afternoons made him languid and dreamy. They made him think about the Basque boy at the drugstore with the raven locks and the long eyelashes. "Listen up, ladies," Margaret's voice, addressing the various cabinets. "Who nabbed my Lysol?" Not a good time to open the shade. "Do you hear me, ladies?" No reply. "If I get knocked up, explosive laughter, probably Sadie's. "I mean it," yelled Margaret. "You ain't having no baby, Grandma." This time it was Violet being mean. Margaret was 45, the oldest girl at the Blue Moon, older even than Andy's mama who ran the place so the other girls could be spiteful. Andy figured they were jealous that Margaret had repeat customers. She was even asked for by name when college boys drove in from Reno, drunk as lords on casino gin. Violet's wisecrack brought raucous laughter from the cabinets, but there was no response at all from Margaret. Andy felt bad for her, so he cupped his hands and yelled through the shade, "There's a bottle of Lysol in the crapper." Another silence, then Margaret spoke in a more subdued tone. "Now there's a gentleman." Andy knew where this was leading. "Want me to get it?" "Would you, lamb? If I move an inch, this tapioca's gonna make its way to glory." I read this for a PBS show called West Coast Live. And they made me sign a paper beforehand that said I wasn't going to say any dirty words. And I thought, okay, tapioca's not a dirty word. The urgency of the mission was underscored by the clanky flatulence of a jalopy coming to life just beyond the cabinets. The customer was already leaving. Andy hurried out to the crapper and found the bottle. By the time he got to Margaret's cabinet with a basin, there was only a distant plume of dust trailing out to the highway. Margaret was sitting on the edge of the bed in her peach camisole. She looked weary and resigned when he set the basin down beside her on the bed. "That's got to be watered down," she said. He nodded. "Already done it." "You have?" She touched the pea-colored solution with a look of tender amazement, as if he had just presented her with the Hope Diamond. "If that don't beat all," she murmured. "Where can I find one like you, Andy?" He shrugged, since it wasn't really a question. Margaret grabbed a sponge off the nightstand and dipped it into the basin, turning away from him as she began to scrub vigorously between her legs. Andy headed straight for the door, eyes to the floor, but Margaret was still talking. "I swear, what did ladies do before Lysol?" Another shrug. "I ain't taking any chances. That Okie has 13 kids of his own." Andy knew that already. Two of the girls were classmates at Humboldt High, compulsive gigglers who lived with their aunt on Mizpah Street. One of them had flirted with Andy on the bus the day before. He wondered if she would be trouble. Margaret knew a lot of things about Andy. She knew things that happened before he was born, back when Mama was teaching piano in Rapid City, and Margaret was her friend working at the Five and Dime. Margaret had already always claimed that they were both ready to get out of there, and the opportunity presented itself when Margaret got pregnant by a piano pupil whose father was, in Margaret's word, a big muckety-muck in the Chamber of Commerce and a hot-headed Greek to boot. Margaret's mean-as-a-snake husband had keeled over dead at the cement plant a week earlier, so she paid her debt to the Almighty by helping Mama through her ordeal. "She was our salvation and our flight from the Pharisees," was how Mama had put it, implicating the unborn Andy in this biblical-sounding event. But it would be years before he would learn that their midnight motor trip to Nevada had been paid for with cash Margaret had lifted from the notions counter at the Five and Dime. He would learn this from Margaret, mind you, not Mama. Mama, when pressed on the matter, had said only that Andy's father was a hero of the Great War who succumbed to his wounds, an explanation that even at the time Andy found unconvincing, since he knew the radio show she was referencing. They had listened to it together, in fact, him and Mama, down in the parlor on a slow night. A doughboy and a crippled Irish girl finding true love in New York City, if only briefly. It embarrassed Andy when Mama's lies became this bold, but he could see how a casualty of war would be easier to explain than some horny 15-year-old she had taught to play Clair de Lune. Even now, Andy's paternity was vague in his mind, since he had never been able to put a grown man's face to that nubile phantom. Mama had been straight with Andy about his business, about her business. She was proud of that story. She and Margaret would tell it in tandem sometimes, playing to a crowd of rowdy customers in the parlor. Mama banging out the funny parts on the piano, shaking everything she had. They had been, quote, two sweet-ass gals flying on a wing and a prayer, though truthfully that prayer had not been uttered until their third night in a Bridge Street hotel when a railroad man, a perfectly nice gent in a suit, offered Margaret $5 to go upstairs and give him a blowjob. Margaret had been a knockout back then, a genuine Swedish blonde with cornflower blue eyes who never forgot her makeup. It had been a natural mistake, Mama had insisted, what with all the plug-ugly women out here in the desert. But maybe it had also been a sign from heaven. Maybe a nice girl, mistaken for something else, had just been shown her true calling in life, especially if she had gone upstairs as readily as Margaret had. Their initial arrangement had been simple. Mama would find the Johns and take their money, and Margaret would haul their ashes. They were already a few girls working in cribs on Bridge Street, so Mama took them under her no-nonsense wing, promising a steady income and protection from the Johns. By the time Andy was born at Humboldt General in the spring of 1920, Mama was offering six ladies, including Margaret, and setting her sights on a big private spread out on the road to Jungo. The old house was already there, so Mama added the cabinets, a semicircle of cinder block huts painted with tall organ pipe cacti, though there was nothing remotely like them growing on that barren expanse. Folks just naturally expected a touch of the Old West when they drove out for pussy in the middle of nowhere. So Mona Ramsey intended to oblige them. Mama used the third person when she got herself really fired up, as if she were talking about someone else entirely. Andy's first memory was not of the house or even the huge neon moon Mama had erected by the highway, but the cool vaulting interior of the Catholic Church on Malarkey Street. At four, Andy was a little too old for a christening, and Mama wasn't even Catholic, but St. Paul's had just been completed, and it was the grandest place in town, a Spanish-style edifice with towers like a castle. Mama wanted folks to see that her son was being raised a proper gentleman. To that end, Margaret had made him a christening outfit with Irish lace she ordered from Denver. Technically, it was a dress, since she had simply enlarged a McCall's pattern meant for babes in arms. But Andy had not complained. He had worn it all day, in fact, chasing a billy goat around the yard. He could still remember how fine it felt against his skin and the flinty look in Mama's eyes when he refused to take it off. When hard times came and poor folks headed west in droves, Mama had never lost faith in the business. There were rumors in town that gambling was about to be legalized in Nevada, and she reckoned that was a good thing, since the fools who went bust at the tables would be even more needful of female consolation. She had been right, as usual. The Blue Moon Lodge thrived, gaining a fresh coat of paint and a scarlet slot machine in the parlor, shiny as a new Hudson and emblazoned with an Indian head. Customers came as far away as Boulder City, where thousands of workers, predictably starved for ladies, were building a colossal new dam. Lately, Mama had her mind set on gold. She had heard from old Mrs. Austin, whose husband ran the general store in Jungo, that Mr. Hoover himself, the former president, had arrived in a private railway car with an oil man from San Francisco and inquired about George Austin's claim in the slumbering hills. It was common knowledge, Mama said, that old George and his college boy sons had been poking in the ground up there. They had recently shipped two bags of gold ore to the mint in San Francisco. Everybody in town was talking about it, but Mrs. Austin had been tight-lipped with Mama, saying only that Mr. Hoover had been a regular feller and that she had grown accustomed to famous folk when she was a nurse in San Jose. The nerve of that woman, said Mama, wielding her fork like a saber at the dinner table. There she is, selling chaw tobacco to the goddamn section hands, and she's acting all high and mighty with me. A tiny fleck of mashed potatoes flew off Mama's fork and hit Violet square in her henna spit curl. Margaret winked at Andy, Violet had not even noticed. The old biddy is about to get filthy rich on that claim, Mama added sourly, and she don't even have the decency to say so. What were you doing in Jungo? This was Delphine, the back-talking Cajun girl, but Andy was wondering the same thing. Jungo was over 30 miles up the road, a pissant little railroad junction that made Winnemucca look like gay Paris. Mama was glowering now. Hush up, Delphine. If you're looking to buy property, there ain't that much poontang in Nevada. Delphine, I mean it. Another word out of you, and you're getting that fatty from Battle Mountain the next time he comes in for a dry bob. Delphine stared down at her plate as a cautious silence fell over the table. Andy knew from experience that it was in everyone's interest to change the subject. None of these girls wanted to give a dry bob to the fatty from Battle Mountain. What famous folks? He asked. Mama frowned at him. Mrs. Austin, he explained. Who did she know? This brought a grunt. Some feller named London, who cares? Jack London? I reckon, yeah. Wow, Andy said under his breath. You heard of him? He wrote The Call of the Wild. We read it in English last year. Mama stabbed a sweetbread with her fork and poked it into her mouth. Well, don't go telling that old battle axe. She's already too big for her britches. A smile flickered at the corner of Margaret's mouth, but she managed to conceal it by turning toward Andy. How was school, Lamb? He shrugged. Okay. You passed your history test? A minus. Get you, said Margaret, beaming. You're heap smarter than the rest of us. Mama shot Margaret a crabby look. Where do you think he got it from? Mama had finished high school while Margaret had dropped out early to go to beauty school in Rapid City. Mama used that dubious advantage to lord it over Margaret whenever they squabbled. Lately, there'd been more squabbles than usual, though Andy was not sure why. Maybe Mama was just worn out. I saw the Watson girl at the post office today, Mama offered, reassembling her face to look more pleasant for Andy. She asked after you. He doubted this was true. If anything, Mama had probably raised the subject herself, since Gloria Watson's family was known to be well fixed. Her father was a doctor, a widowed doctor, to boot, who had once conducted the monthly exams at the Blue Moon. Mama's coquettish overtures had failed to get a rise out of him, and most likely scared him off the job. So now she was working on his daughter. I think she's taken a shine to you, Andy. Andy sighed so she could hear it. What's the matter with Gloria Watson? Nothing. She's very nice. She's dating the class president, that's all. Well, that don't make no never mind. Margaret glanced at Mama sideways. Leave him be, Mona. Andy's a damn sight better looking than any class president. Mona. Well, look at him, Margaret. He could get any pretty girl he wants. Andy rolled his eyes. You're a stitch, Mama. Don't you sass me, kid. You know I'm right. He stayed calm and smiling as he rose and took his plate to the sink. Half the time, Mama was just spoiling for a fight, so he had learned not to engage her. I've got homework, he said, heading off to his room. By 9 o'clock, the yard was full of cars, so Andy stayed in his room, reading under a lampshade printed with a map of the world. Down below, he could hear the usual music from the Victrola, the usual howls from the customers and counterfeit squeals from the girls. Not an awful sound, really, just an awfully familiar one, and the wrong accompaniment to Richard Halliburton's Book of Marvels. He wondered if Mama truly wanted to go on like this forever, selling good-for-all-night tokens unto death, or if she ever dreamed of being somewhere else entirely. That would be fine with him, unless her escape plan involved the acquisition of a wealthy daughter-in-law, in which case leaving would be just as grimly unimaginable as staying. He had just turned 16, though. There was still time to figure it out. You there, Lamb? Margaret was cooing from outside the door, so he invited her in. She was wearing a calf-length green velvet gown that was balding in places like the arm of an old settee. Her palomino hair was now loosely corralled on top of her head with a bobby pin. She was holding a parcel about the size of a shoebox, wrapped in the funny papers and tied up with twine. "Guess what's playing at the American next week?" "What?" he replied, before snatching an answer out of the blue. "Charlie Chan." She sat down on the edge of the bed, setting the parcel beside her. "Much better. Jeanette McDonald." "Oh," he said, remembering San Francisco. He had passed the glass-encrusted poster on his way to Eagle Drugs, but the chance of laying eyes on the Basque boy again had dulled its impact considerably. "With Clark Gable." "Together for the first time," said Margaret, quoting the poster. Andy did not much care for Clark Gable, with his big tombstone teeth and wooden ways, even if he had starred in Call of the Wild. It was the dog that Andy had most admired in that film. Jeanette McDonald, on the other hand, was ladylike elegance itself and not to be missed under any circumstances. "Wonder if she sings," he said. "I expect so." Margaret gave him a winsome smile. "Want to go on Saturday?" "Sure. Unless you got some chum you'd rather take." "No." She clamped her hands on her knees and stood up. "Well then, okay, it's a date." She headed for the door, leaving the parcel behind her on the bed. "What's that?" he asked. She stopped in the doorway and silenced him with a finger to her lips. "Happy birthday, lamb." "Latch the door behind me." His heart was pounding wildly as he obeyed her order, pushing the metal hook into the rusty eye on the door frame. He had used this latch hundreds of times before without giving it a second thought, but now, with the din of strangers rising from the parlor, it struck him as woefully inadequate for any secret worth keeping. He went to the bed and sat where Margaret had sat, pulling the parcel into his lap. It was soft and squishy, obviously fabric, but lighter than the woolen shirt she had made him last Christmas, or even the seersucker suit of an earlier birthday. The twine on the parcel was so lightly knotted that he finally gave up the effort and tore a hole in the newspaper, a Maggie and Jiggs comic in which Maggie, as usual, was chasing Jiggs around with a rolling pin. Within seconds, he had liberated the contents, a billowing cloud of lemon silk chiffon printed with roses in pale pinks and greens. The betrayal blooming in his lap made his eyes dart to the door again. The latch was still firmly in place, but true reassurance came in the fact that Mama had turned off the Victrola and started playing the piano. That meant folks would stay put for a while. She was playing her favorite song, "Smoke Gets in Your Eyes." He rose and went to the corroded mirror on the back of the closet door. The gown was long and sleeveless. There were cape-like flounces at the shoulders and hand-rolled seams at the neckline, all of it diaphanous as a dream from which he was sure to wake at any moment. He slipped it over his head as Mama began to sing. "They asked me how I knew my true love was true. I, of course, replied, something here inside cannot be denied." The tissue-fine silk slid down Andy's body like a lover's whisper. Here we are. The word I learned on Bing dry bob was the expression. I use it all through the book, and I never tell people what dry bob is, so they have to go to their computer to find it out. She just said, "Do you know?" He said, "No, no." Let's talk. Ask me some questions.
What's a dry bob?
It's penetration without ejaculation. Apparently, in brothel terms, it's cheaper because it's not as messy. The Lysol detail I also found on the internet.
Was that used as a spermicide?
Yeah, it was. By women for a number of years, Lysol sold it that way. And later, when they couldn't get away with that anymore, they sold it as a freshener, a personal freshener. I saw ads in Look magazine where they would, there would be like the husband and wife, and the husband was like, and the wife was, and the headline was, "For the secret even your husband won't tell you. For the problem even your husband won't tell you." But it seems to me like the problem would be that she smells like the kitchen floor. But it was there, and it was amazing to be able to time travel, you know, and find these things. Anna, in the first chapter at 92, has a copy of Richard Halliburton's Book of Marvels, which is referenced here. And she's sort of teasing Jake, her companion, because he's there with his e-reader, and she's got the Book of Marvels, and she's I can smell my book. You can't smell your book, and her book smells like rose water and Lysol, which is the smell of the Blue Moon Lodge. So it's sort of it's like Proust's Madeleine, the sensory experience that takes her into the past. That and a big vaporizer with some pot from a local cannabis club. Yes, sir.
Can you talk about what it was like as you put the finishing touches on this manuscript, considering it's the end of such a long-running story?
Did you hear the question? He's asking about what it was like to put the finishing touches on a long-running story. I was exhilarated when I got to the last two pages because they kind of wrote themselves. That almost never happens, but I suddenly had, it was off and running in some weird way that I hadn't for the entire book. Just a visual that took me out of it. I felt less melancholy then than I do right now on book tour because I'm sort of feeling the impact. I'm seeing people, they're saying really nice things to me. So it's like any beautiful closure. It's beautiful and it's closing, and it was it's oddly disarming right now. I'm not sorry I did it. I thought it was time. It had the right shape to me. This is book number 9. There are three trilogies. Basically, the first one was pre-AIDS, the second one was post-AIDS, and this is in the new millennium when everybody's pretty old. The realization that these people are old is making me realize that I'm not going to escape it, however hard I write. Very unusual thing. And people also who have grown up with these books have said the same thing to me, that it's really making them feel, not their so much their age, but their moment, a moment in their lives. So I've been given a gift. It's an amazing thing to have something that has this kind of power over 40 years. That it's not one of those series where they all remain pretty much the same and just have adventures. They really are getting old and getting sick, and in some cases dying, and getting wise, learning things, finding love eventually. All of that. So it was mixed, a lot of mixed emotions around it all. Yes?
In your research for the book, did you go to Burning Man?
I did. I was dragged kicking and screaming to Burning Man by my 28 years younger husband. We went for our second time last year, so obviously I must have really had a good time the first time. I'm not fond of dust and heat and camping out and hauling in your own food and water and listening to dance music all night long. Never have been, actually. Even when I was young, I wanted to go home and go to bed. Michael says in the book, I've never liked an all-nighter, and this is an all-weeker. You get there, and there is a visual treat like you have never experienced anywhere. Has anybody been to Burning Man? There we go. Did you have a good time? It's beautiful. That was what struck me. It's just beautiful. I describe it as a Fellini carnival on Mars in the book, trying to let people grasp exactly what the experience is. But there, you know, there's, ever since L-Wire came into being, it's this just phantasmagoria of color. And you see a cityscape, but there are no commercial, there's no commercial neon. There's nothing you recognize. It's just large stretches of splendid color and great imaginative things that are funny, that make you laugh. It has an enormous sense of humor about itself. People create really wacky stuff. I was reading the program. I put this in the book. I was reading the program, and there was some event that was being held at Dr. Scroat's circumcision wagon and calamari hut. there's something called a hug deli. You're out in the middle of nowhere, and there's a little booth, like something you'd see in a Roadrunner cartoon, like a little general store, just right. You can't see anything. There's just whiteness all around you. And there's a guy, a sort of hippie dude from L.A., I think I found out, who runs the hug deli, and they have the affectionate hug, the Beverly Hills air kiss hug, the long uncomfortable hug, and there's no money changing hands, so you pick the one you want, and then he gives you that hug. I have Shauna, the youngest character in the book. Has that experience. The porta potties are infamous, as porta potties tend to be. You just plan your day around getting over going to the porta potties. Absolutely vile. It's 60,000 people in the desert, you know, basically using the same porta potties, because even people with RVs can't use them, because you can't. Take out your gray water, or whatever they call it. Don't get me started. But how do they make something fun out of the porta potties? One camp had a thing they set up. They'd wait till somebody would go in. They'd pick a person, wait till they went into a porta potty, and when that person came out, a red carpet had been rolled from the front of the porta potty. There were bleachers on the side with cheering people and paparazzi, and a receiving stand with someone. They were just completely celebrated as a movie star as they came out of the porta potty. But it's really a lot of fun, and it's sweet. There's a lot of genuine camaraderie, kindness. People have playa names. You make up a name for yourself. I guess it partially diminishes the embarrassment that you're in a tutu and you're or whatever, however you're dressed for the first time. And I had named myself Sofa Daddy because I like sofas, and they had them all over the place. You know, people hauled sofas out to the middle of the desert, and so if a camp had a sofa, I was headed there.
But that was Mouse's name. Are you a mouse?
Oh, no. No, I'm not. I'm sort of. I use things for me, for Mouse, but yes, it is his book, the name of the thing. You can't say, yes, that's me, because some of the things that happen here did not happen to me. My grumpy attitude about it is reflected in Mouse at the beginning of the book. And my husband did buy a sewing machine just for this, and went to some lady in the Marina District in San Francisco who taught him to sew in an afternoon. And he was making, almost through instinctively, was making wonderful costumes for us. There's a class division, interesting class division at Burning Man, where the people who've been going for a long time and are proud of the roughing it element of it all, and what do they call it, radical self-sufficiency. You know, it's not really radical self-sufficiency if you have to stop at Home Depot before you go. I mean, you really have to spend a lot of money preparing yourself for your radical self-sufficiency. And some people who have the money fly in for a day or two, and they have very elegant RVs set up, and a staff, and barbecue is served in the common area. And naturally, I had Marianne do that in this book. She says that her RV looks like Reba McEntire's tour bus, and it kind of does. So I had fun exploring all of those notions with Burning Man. We're not going back this year, taking a little bit of a break. It feels like it's barely over before you have to start planning for it again, because there's so much pre-planning is necessary, but it's really worth doing. Yes?
All of the books are based in San Francisco, except for this one. Was that on purpose, that you took them out of the element of, you know, the other character being the city?
Yes. Not really. It occurred to me after I'd done it that that's what had happened, and I don't want people to think, oh, this is his. In some ways, I suppose there's an element of saying goodbye to the city, so you feel this journey that they're all on that's away from San Francisco. But it really had to do with the fact that I had the Burning Man material in my head, and that I wanted Anna to go back to Winnemucca, and I wanted to write a story that wasn't in my own time. I wanted to do historical fiction, if you will. Yes, sir.
So speaking of the class distinction, you mentioned in the book a little bit about the issue in San Francisco with all the tech workers taking over, making the rents go high, all of that. I'm kind of curious what your perspective is on that, and if that had any impact on your decision to move away.
Our decision to move away was partially a matter of finances, that we could get something nicer and bigger and with a great deal of character in Santa Fe. I cannot, in my heart of hearts, trace it back to tech workers invading the city. Life changes. That's just the way it is. When I came to San Francisco in the early 70s, Herb Kane, our leading columnist, was complaining about how it wasn't nearly as much fun as it was in the 30s and 40s when Benny Goodman was there, you know. Yes, it's alarming how the prices have gone up, but what am I going to say? If I were a tech worker, if I were, you know, I worked for any of our local tech companies, and I would want a place in San Francisco. I would want to come and find the neighborhood that I lived in and find something nice for myself. And if I had the money to do it, I would do it. And I cannot freak out over the Google bus because it's a bus. If all those people were driving cars, that would be a higher impact on the city. I mean, maybe there's not, something I'm not seeing here, but it strikes me as a thoughtful thing.
To the whole issue, or do you think that it's just something that folks are going to have to get used to?
I don't know who's going to be even getting used to it, because it'll be other people that are living there, because I was exchanging a realtor on Facebook said, I'd said something about it'd be nice to have a little pied-à-terre still in San Francisco, and he said, what would you like? And I told him, and his response was naming the money, how much we could spend, and that we wanted to be pet friendly and have a parking place. And he wrote back, I think you're going to have to put out for this. The whole city, this is just something that's happened. I don't hate the people that are making it happen. It's the way that life changes.
I was fortunate to see the musical, Tales of the City musical, a couple of years ago, and just wondering if there's anything going on with that, any further tours, productions?
I wish. He's talking about the Tales of the City musical that was at ACT. It was very popular, extended three times in the city, and we knew creatively what needed to be done to it to make it better, but so far there's no forward momentum about getting to do that somewhere. It didn't help that our creative team were also young and talented, that they got hired off in three different directions immediately after it happened. So I don't know. I don't think that's going to happen. I wish I could be hopeful about that, but I don't think we're going to see that again. You saw a rare thing, if you saw it. Julie, you liked it. Good.
Oh, yeah. I did, too. I'm obviously a huge fan of the books and the miniseries and everything, but yeah. It was so great to, you know, be in the presence. You know?
And it's wonderful cast. Yeah. Wes Taylor playing Mouse. I think that's the best Mouse of all. He really caught his spirit. Betsy Wolfe is Marianne. She's gone on to be a big Broadway star, basically, and to sing at the Met and Deflate a Mouse 3 weeks ago. Yes?
An online question. So what's next for you? Do you have a new series in mind, perhaps inspired by your second Burning Man?
A new series inspired by my second Burning Man? No, I'm not. Don't have that in mind. I don't know. I'm allowing myself a little breathing room now that I have it. Keeping in mind that the mortgage still has to be paid. But I've thought about memoir because I have had a number of interesting things happen over the years that might make for good memoir. And I've actually talked to my husband Christopher about a one-man show, a thing I could take around, we could take around. We have this fantasy of having like an Airstream trailer and and doing Uncle Armistead's medicine show or something and taking along our friend Matt Alber, who's a singer-songwriter, and putting on a little thing we could do. We could go to places where I'm not normally sent on book tours and you know, support ourselves with it. Yes?
And how are you going to deal with the end of the... Are you going to do another book? Are there going to be these characters? I don't want to lose them. Can you continue with Mouse?
We have a support program for that. For $300 a weekend, you can gather in a room with similarly troubled people. And I will make up things that have happened to them. I'm being completely glib. No, I don't have plans for their further, you know, for their continuation. This is the end of the series. Yes?
A little bit about your writing process.
My writing process. I generally write in the morning. Try to start in the morning. One of those energy, there's better energy. I do this weird thing. I know other writers who do it too. I go to sleep thinking about the story, but not in any kind of formal way. Just kind of, I used to do it as a kid. I told myself stories. I had serials. I had three different serials running in my head when I was a child. And I would move them a little further along as I went to sleep. It became a sort of a technique for going to sleep. Now I require Ambien, Alteril, and a couple of tokes on a joint. But I still do it. I still let the story percolate while I'm sleeping, I guess is the best way to put it. And then it's just hard. It's just grunt work. My friend Anne Lamott has written a wonderful book called Bird by Bird. You know it, yeah. And I always think about it because she reminds me that you just have to basically write about a moment. Tell yourself, I'm not writing a novel, I'm just writing the moment when the woman comes in the room and talks to her daughter. And that's it. That's all I'm doing. I'm not going to freak out on it. I'm just doing that scene. And then you do another one the next day. And that's how this happened, you know. It's two pages at the most every time I discipline myself to sit down and write.
Do you know how it's going to end? I mean, do you already know that? Are you trying to get to that destination?
I had roughly in mind how this was going to loop back on itself, but not really. I have a sort of general road map in mind. In this case, quite literally, there are two different road trips that are going on, and then I let detours pop up as they will. So partially it's about keeping myself surprised. And it's about play, too, finding the playful heart of what you do. I wasn't entirely joking about I don't smoke it the way I did in the past, and I use vaporizers, but a little puff on a vaporizer can sometimes put me right in the place to continue with that play. I don't try to actually contact with the keys in that state. I'm perfectly sober when I actually write, but the two, it works, they work together. Yes?
I'm a huge fan, obviously, and I know I'm not alone. And when I came out years ago, my friends pointed me to the series, and I read the first three, and they've been an amazing kind of, you know, almost charter for, you know, me coming out.
Were here any closer, I'd be hugging you right now. I love hearing that. Thank you very much.
I don't know if you set out to write something that people who were coming out could kind of identify with, and I wonder if, now that you look back on the legacy of 9 books, if you have any special message for people who are coming out today. You know, it's a very different world than what you wrote, the original books, but I think so much of it is still applicable. I'm curious to hear your words on that.
Thank you very, very much. What happened to me was I was coming out in the process of writing this. I was working at the San Francisco Chronicle telling the story. I'd already introduced a gay character, but I had a bunch of other characters, so it wasn't going to incriminate me with my family back home who were following the serial. But then Anita Bryant began her campaign in South Florida, and like a lot of other people of my generations, we said, that's it, that's enough. And we understood that the power, that how we could take power was by making ourselves public, by showing the world who we were. And I had this amazing vehicle where I could do it. I had already decided that Michael Tolliver should be the son of Florida orange growers. And Anita Bryant, of course, was a spokesperson for Florida orange juice. So I had Michael's mother write him and say, how proudly say that she had joined the Anita Bryant Save Our Children campaign. And Michael writes back to say, hey, guess what? Your own child is gay and I don't need saving. And that letter, which took me 45 minutes to write, has been reprinted and used more than any other thing I've ever read. It was made into a big choral piece for gay choruses. Jake Shears made it into a very sweet little song for the musical. It's had its own life. And I realized at that point that that was my purpose. The activism is entirely intentional. And it's the activism that just that emerges from the fact that gay people are not only in it, they are there in it alongside their straight and trans friends. And everything's fine. It's working for them. And I knew that's what I could say to the world. And I was accused of sort of utopianism at the beginning. But I don't feel it. It's caught up. I watched the Grammys the other night, and Christopher and I were sitting there weeping on the sofa. I was also shaking my fist at Queen Latifah, by the way. But eventually, maybe after she's married 30 couples in public, she herself will come out. Mm-hmm. It was very moving to and here, right from Seattle, Macklemore and Ryan Lewis, Seattle bred and born and internet bred. I mean, am I not right? They did this basically off a YouTube video, or they're spreading this word to this whole room full of people who are equally moved. I mean, you looked out there and saw all those big stars crying while that was going on. The world has changed right in front of our eyes. There was a time when that would not been permitted at all. And the only time I ever say anything to younger generations, because I think fundamentally they're a lot smarter than my generation in many, many ways, is that know where it's come from, you know. Know that when I started writing Tales of the City, my love was both a crime and a mental illness. And that's happened in these 40 years. And it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful time to be LGBT and in the world, to feel the wheels of history like this. And you had the second part to that question. I can't even remember what it was now. But
if you have anything anything to say to people coming out today?
Yeah, just first of all, do it. It's important. Do not let people just sort of minimize it and say, oh, it doesn't matter anymore. We're all everything. Well, yes, you are, but that's usually said in avoidance of saying that you're gay or that you, you know, it is. It must be said. We're not too sophisticated for that yet, obviously, as Queen Latifah proved the other night. There's work that has yet to be done. And I like her, by the way, very much. I just want her to be happy and admit that her personal trainer is her girlfriend or whatever it is. Yes?
I'm hearing a little bit more every year about the nostalgia of the old society where gays were sub and hidden, and the tantalization of being a hidden subculture. Do you feel that? Do you see that at all?
Fuck that shit. That's pretty much the answer. I hear it. I see it around, and I actually see people of my generation. But there's usually some shame involved. Gore Vidal has talked in his, you know, in some of his last memoirs, he talked about, oh, how great it was in the old days because you could get more straight men into bed with you because things weren't defined as the way they are now. And there was shame attached to everything, shame and criminality. And danger, not things that I like to have as a component of my love life. So I don't miss it at all. I mean, I'm happy where we are today, and I'm happy that young people do not have to go through the torment. Many of them don't. Many of them in our country. There's a worldwide epidemic of institutional homophobia that we have to address now in places like Nigeria and Russia. And I think that that's what we're here for. I think that's what the people who've made the journey and are happy with themselves and aren't putting up with the shit anymore, we need to make it right for others, help to make it right for others. But no, I don't have that nostalgia of the bushes or whatever it is. At all. You know, we've all got imaginations. We can be nasty anywhere we want at any time. I think a good sex life, whether you're gay, straight, or stray, is about having an imagination. And that goes, I have to say, with getting older. The libido doesn't veer up as frequently, but it can be wonderful. I always like to quote Aunt Augusta from Travels with My Aunt, the great Graham Greene novel, where it helps to know that she's played by Maggie Smith in the movie, where she says, I've always preferred an occasional orgy to nightly routine. I think of that often. Yes?
I remember after Surety was written that you were very adamant about, I'm not coming back to the series, I'm never going to
finish
it again.
Yeah, I know.
And I was very surprised when the first book came out, and now I haven't read it, but the closure of this. So what drew you out to write these last three books? And sort of your question is like, could there be some time in between and all of a sudden that same thing?
You're saying you don't know how to believe me anymore, is that what it is? I don't blame you. The motivation for stopping with Sure of You was that I had established that Michael Tolliver was HIV positive. And in 1989, that was a death sentence. So I thought I had written a series of books in which it made it clear that Michael, the everyman, had this thing that it was taking so many of my friends. I didn't want to continue because I didn't want to write one more story where the gay man dies at the end. Or the gay character, period. When you saw movies, Vito Russo's wonderful Celluloid Closet was about that, about how movies always, we had to pay for it. We paid for it. We might have had our fun, but we would die. Or like in I think it's a movie called The Fox with the lesbians where one of them has a tree fall on her. you paid for it. And that way the viewing audience saw that it wasn't being endorsed by the filmmakers. And I didn't want to do that in Tales. I wanted to leave him bravely fighting. And then after the millennium came about and I started thinking about what I wanted to do next, and I thought, well, I'll write a novel about a gay man who survived. I would celebrate my own generation. And then I realized I had that guy. I had Michael Tolliver, and people were familiar with his history, so it would have an extra resonance. So I wrote that. That's the only one that's been written in first person. Got a lot of criticism for it because people thought it was heavily autobiographical. I used a lot, but I'm negative, HIV negative myself, so that wasn't me. Said that it wasn't part of the Tales of the City series because I didn't want to disappoint people who were used to the old multi-character tapestry. And so that's how I got back into it. And then as soon as I got into Michael Tolliver Lives, all the other characters were madly auditioning to be in it. I put them in and... Yeah. And the big health crisis that comes to Marianne in Marianne in Autumn was something being experienced by a close friend of mine, so I had a close-up look at that, and I wanted to use it. And it just kind of got me back into the swim of it. So that's kind of the reason. Yes?
As you think about the team of people that works with you, editor, publicist, et cetera, to bring a book like this to life, what would you say are some of the most important functions where you need alignment?
Among the people that help out to bring a book to life? First of all, if you have a good editor, that's really, if you have a hands-on editor, that's a great thing. Somebody who knows what you're trying to do and looks at it. Publicity is not to be underestimated. I'm standing here right now because the publicity department arranged it and got me here. Because nobody knows you have a book out, then it doesn't work. I didn't get into social networking until about 5 years ago when my husband said, you really should, and now I'm just this most pathetic old Facebook geezer. Sitting there with all these other old people scrapbooking online, you know. And here's how good I looked in 1982, you know. It's very useful for older people, actually. And maybe only that particular one. I'm still not really terribly comfortable on Twitter. And I know that people refer to Facebook as facelift. And, it's been terrific for me. This is probably not the right group to ask, because you're here because you're with Microsoft, and I was put with Microsoft. Does anybody follow me on, oh, there we are. On Facebook. Yeah, great. Thank you. I think that's very useful for a writer particularly, because you can directly hook up with the people who like your work. They've already been on there and liked you or whatever, and you can hook up with them, and then when you go to a city, you could say, I'm coming tomorrow and I'll be so-and-so, and I've watched it happen in bookstores repeatedly. That's recommended. I don't want to minimize anybody else's job at a publishing house, but it's all a team. Do you have a book you're...
I'm toying with something, and I'm trying to understand what are the different functions and elements and words most important.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you have a few minutes afterward, I'd love to maybe just take it offline for a couple minutes.
Okay. I mean, happily, you just don't want to do it publicly, I understand. Agent, by the way, agent. I should have probably started with that. Yes?
Any modern authors that you think might be carrying the torch?
Of what?
Of what you're...
There will be none after me.
do you you have any modern authors that you like?
Oh, sure. Sure, and it's always hard to immediately name them, but and some of them are not that much younger than I am, but I love the work of Peter Cameron, Patrick Gale, who's an English writer. Where do I start? What have I been reading lately? I read that Gone Girl thing this year, and I could not put it down. I thought it was so beautifully written. I thought that's a really well-deserved success. Gillian Flynn. Annie Lamott, I talked about her manual earlier, but her writing in general is just beautiful and humane. It's always my least favorite question because I can't conjure it up right away, but those are some of them. No, it's a legitimate question. And I would like to be able to serve my fellow authors by trotting out their names, but I'm not doing it right now, am I?
Time for one more question.
Yes, sir.
Actually, this is more just a thank you. The books you wrote sort of helped illuminate and are a companion for very interesting times in my life in California in the 70s and 80s. And you illustrated the frightening, the horror of the plague coming like very few other people. And I remember that time in my life as friends died. And the books have meant a lot to me.
Thank you, sir, very much. I appreciate that. It's been my pleasure and honor, I might say, having the opportunity to tell these stories. And thank you very much for coming today.